and choice theory itself was published in 1998. And since then, I've written 8 more books. Many of them I have here for sale, but these books are all fundamentally based on the choice theory ideas. But the psychiatrists have created the book, the DSM-IV, and that's the book they claim of mental illnesses. I claim it's a book which somewhat, not even accurately, describes a lot of psychological symptoms, but none of the symptoms in the book could really be classified as illnesses. And this was, of course, not my idea to begin with, although I accepted it immediately. Thomas Szasz had that idea back in the 60s, I think 61, when he wrote The Myth of Mental Illness. And then Peter Bregan followed it up with Toxic Psychiatry, which really points out that not only is psychiatry not the cause of mental illness, what psychiatry does by the prescription of psychiatric drugs is really, it's toxic to the people that take the drugs, and that's been verified over and over. And a man named Robert Whitaker, his book is for sale here called Mad in America, and shortly he'll be coming out with another book which goes into the other so-called psychiatric diseases, like, you know, depression and those others, all of which are called diseases and all of which are pretty much accepted by the general public as well. I mean, if psychiatrists call them diseases, they must be diseases. And so the idea of psychiatric illness has been around for over 100 years, and it's gotten into the what's called common thinking, commonly accepted, common practice. Now, I've never accepted it myself. I never accepted that the people I dealt with initially in the mental hospital at the Veterans Administration, who were diagnosed almost all schizophrenic. Now, they had various kinds. I don't remember all the kinds. Simple, hypophrenic, paranoid, a variety of catatonic, I think, was the other one. But that was just a description of their symptoms. It didn't mean that they had a psychiatric disease. And I found that out very early in my residency when I was just starting out. And when you're a psychiatric resident, and I was at the Veterans Administration in West Los Angeles, supervised by the Department of Psychiatry at UCLA, but pretty much left alone, which is a wonderful way to start out. They just let you be. I had 54 patients on my ward, and I took care of them for a long period of time, almost a year, and then I went on to some of the other psychiatric wards in the hospital. I was on the women's ward in the hospital, and those patients were mostly diagnosed schizophrenia. Also, at the time I started, the new drug Thorazine was just coming into the pharmacological book, or whatever that book of pharmacology is called. And Thorazine is still being used, although not being used as much. It's been replaced by drugs like Haldol and Prolixin. And then the third generation is Zyprexin and Risperidol and drugs like that going up the line. Also, if you pay attention to what's going to be in Whitaker's new book, I have a little interview he granted to someone, and it was sent to me. And Whitaker points out that when mental illnesses were first being described in the early part of the century, maybe one person in 400 or something like that was actually diagnosed as mentally ill. Then when the drugs came along and the psychiatric pharmaceutical manufacturers, the manufacturers of psychiatric drugs came along and found they had a gold mine in these drugs, then more and more people became diagnosed with psychiatric symptoms. They couldn't give them to people themselves, but they needed a person who could write prescriptions. So psychiatrists and medical doctors now write most of the prescriptions for psychiatric drugs, even though still, if you ask any psychiatrist or any medical doctor, well, what actually is the cause of this disease that you're writing the prescription for? And they'll tell you, well, the cause is a chemical imbalance in the brain. Well, what is the chemical imbalance? What tests are for the chemical imbalance? with their blood tests or SRIs or all those various fancy tests, x-ray, is there any particular test for any mental illness that's described in the DSM-4, described by psychiatrists in the DSM-4? And actually, there is no test. There is no pathology in the brains of anyone. And people, when I say that, people say, even schizophrenic people? And I say, even schizophrenic people. You can have identical twins, and one can have schizophrenic symptoms, and one not. So they have identical brains. And then, of course, we also have the movie, the book first, which I read, called A Beautiful Mind by Sylvia Nasser. And after that book, they came the movie A Beautiful Mind, a movie that was relatively a good representation of the book, but with some flaws, that John Forbes Nash Jr., who was the hero, if you could call that the hero of that movie, John Forbes Nash never had any visual hallucinations. But how could you make a movie about hallucinations and just stick to auditory hallucinations? What would the audience grasp? Well, the man that directed the movie felt they wouldn't grasp very much, so he used a little theatrical license and added little hallucinations of a little girl and other visual hallucinations to kind of flesh the movie out. But the movie was correct in most instances. He did become, he became having hallucinations and delusions in 1959 after having been quite a successful physicist, even as a very young man. But unfortunately for him, as a very young man, he expected to get the field prize for mathematics, which is the key prize in the world for mathematical, inventive or intuitive or creative mathematical ideas. But as the movie described or portrayed John Nash, he wasn't really a very attractive personality. He kind of grumpy and made fun of people, and he didn't make very many friends. And he didn't even make enough friends with the woman that bore his first child, John Steers Nash Jr., who was born now 50-some years of age, that this child even gets along with him, because although he was a moderately affluent young man, I guess family money, he was kind of stingy. And he hooked up with a woman named Eleanor Steers, and she slept with him and made food for him and everything, but he wouldn't give her any money, so they had a child together, and she had actually put the child in a foster home because she couldn't afford to keep the child. And the child still feels quite badly about that, knows about it now, and doesn't like him very much. But the child is not afflicted with psychological symptoms. However, his own child, by his one wife that he's married, she divorced him and then remarried many years later. In the movie, it seems as if they were never divorced, but she divorced him in 1959 because he was, again, he became crazy, and she felt he was always going to be crazy, and doctors intimated that he wasn't going to get over this. And so she kept house for him and did good things for him, but divorced him and didn't marry him again until 4 years after he recovered from his schizophrenia. Now, why did he recover from his schizophrenia? Did he recover from psychiatric medication? No. He didn't take any after 1970. The movie kind of intimated that, although there was a voiceover in the movie that said his unexpected recovery was probably due to the effects of modern psychotropic medication, which is absolutely not true. I imagine the movie received a dollar or two to put that line in, and Hollywood movies have no particular reason not to say anything if they're paid enough for them. So they're not really the moral compasses of the world. Anyway, after he was cured by being given the Nobel Prize. Now, when they gave him the Nobel Prize, the movie described that quite, I'm assuming most people have seen it, described that quite well. They asked him, how are you going to be when we give you the prize in front of 1,000 members of the Swedish Academy? Do we have to worry that you'll be unstable? Like, they couldn't exactly say it to him. He says, no. He said, I'll be perfectly okay. And since 1994, it's almost, you know, it's over 10 years later, he's been stable ever since. I heard him on 60 Minutes and he describes, he said, I willed myself back to sanity. Well, probably he did wheel himself back to sanity, but he didn't will himself from any brain damage if his so-called illness was caused by pathology in his brain, which is taught in every university and maybe even be taught by people at this conference, I don't know. But certainly Peter Bregan does not teach that. Peter Bregan is one of the first people that searched the literature high and low and discovered there is no pathology in the brains of people with schizophrenia or bipolar disorder or any of the major or minor disorders. Their brains are perfectly normal. A normal brain is perfectly capable of being quite creative, and part of the brain's creativity, a normal brain, is to create hallucinations and delusions, and the people really do hear voices and things like that. But John Forbes Nash says, I still hear the voices, but now I recognize they're being created in my own brain. And I had a client like that in one of my books who said to me, she was diagnosed with schizophrenia, which I didn't believe she had. And I worked with her for about 3 or 4 months and made a good relationship with her. And I had known her as a child, and it's written up in my book. I have a case book there called Counseling with Choice Theory, The New Reality Therapy. And after seeing her, I wasn't allowed to see her as a psychiatrist because at the UCLA Department of Psychiatry, because I never believed in mental illness and I never believed in psychiatric drugs, I became persona, so I wasn't accepted when the department was all psychoanalytic because I wouldn't believe in psychoanalysis and I wouldn't believe in psychiatric drugs, but I was allowed to see her as a visitor. Her mother signed for me and she wanted to see me, and I saw her and talked with her, and as I'll describe how I do counseling, made a relationship with her. And as I made the relationship with her, she asked me, because she was doing pretty well. She was on psychiatric medication in the hospital, but soon they took her off it when she obviously became quite sane. And she said to me, the critical question she asked me, she said, Dr. Glasser, can you be sane and still hear voices? Because that's what brought her to the hospital, hearing voices. And I said, if you know their voices being created in your own brain, then you're somewhat creative, but there's nothing wrong with your brain, you're not insane. And now that you've asked me that question, I think that you'll begin to stop hearing the voices, which she did, and it's now almost 20 years later, and I've still followed her, and she's a professor of physics at a junior college in Los Angeles, and really enjoys her job and enjoys her students and gets along quite well, even though she had a psychiatric break. And then if you read the history of schizophrenia, which I think some people will be talking about, you'll find that it's very recoverable if you don't treat it, as long as the person with the so-called diagnosis gets support from people around them, especially the family members, then eventually it goes away and they return to normal. But if they have modern psychiatric treatment, where they're number one, told they're crazy, number two, told there's something wrong with your brain, number three, told the only thing that can help you is probably psychiatric medication, then these people, 99% today in the United States and Europe and other places, first world countries, if you hear voices and you describe yourself as suffering from the symptoms of schizophrenia, then it's almost a certainty that you'll be medicated. And then it's almost a certainty that your chances of recovering from these symptoms, you never had a disease in the first place, but even recovering from the creative symptoms will not be usual for you. Some people do recover, but nowhere near the people who would have recovered if they hadn't been treated with these strong medications, which actually cause a chemical imbalance in the brain. That's how they work. Peter Breggin pointed this out very, very completely in his book, Toxic Psychiatry. He has further books following up. Your drug may be your problem. But Peter Breggin has never believed in this, and I've never believed in it. And that's how eventually we got together and I became a member of this organization. But what I'm trying to do now is move beyond the idea of saying that there is no psychiatric illness, saying that psychotropic chemicals can be harmful to your brain. And I wrote my last book called Warning: Psychiatry Can Be Hazardous to Your Mental Health. And I wrote that because I believe there is such a thing as mental health. And if you talk to any psychiatrist, almost all psychologists, social workers, counselors, and various people who work with people who are diagnosed on the DSM-4, and ask them, well, what would you call yourself? And most of them will call themselves, because they're professionals, mental health professionals. But if you go ahead and ask almost any mental health professional to describe or define mental health, they'll define it or describe it as an absence of disease. You're mentally healthy if you don't have a brain disease. But that really, in my opinion, is not a very good definition of mental health. You can be a couch potato and be very, very short of breath when you exercise and all that, and still be physically healthy and go to a doctor who will tell you you're not physically ill, but you're hardly physically healthy, and you'll come to the conclusion with the doctor. He'll either tell you this, you already have come to this conclusion, you're out of shape. Out of shape is when you're not as physically healthy as you would like to be. Now, if you're out of shape and you want to get back into shape, that's not a very difficult thing to do. All you have to do, and there's a latest research, I heard it on the radio, that points this out for people at losing weight and things like that, that if you want to lose weight, you have to cut down your caloric intake moderately, because if you cut down too much, you'll get hungry and you'll start eating, but moderately, most people can live with a moderate cut down, and do some moderate exercise. The research has shown that if you cut down 250 calories a day, which isn't very much, a little bit under 2,000 calories for most people, and if you exercise enough to burn 250 calories, which would be about 20 minutes on a treadmill or something like that, then every month you'll lose about a pound, and in a year you'll lose, 12 pounds. And it's not much, but if you don't do that, you probably won't lose any. And if you continue for a few years, you'll lose more and more weight over the time, and you'll become physically healthier. Now, the problem with that is it's not very pleasant. People don't like to diet and exercise. Therefore, all diets, and they've studied this and this research pointed out again, all diets, which include